20 minutes.
No. No one there, no? I think Miss Sakati.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Honorable Chair, we are living in today's world in an era of dilemma, an era of unspeakable horrors, an era where extremism has rendered us all hostage. This is an era of extreme confusion. We have looked to our allies in peace, and some amongst them have looked to hold us as villains instead of as also victims of a global conspiracy. Our allies, in peace have forgotten that we stood with them even in the face of adversity. Honorable Chair, I wish to table this book. This is Dr. Lona Devaraja, first published in 1994, The Muslims of Sri Lanka, 1,000 Years of Ethnic Harmony. This book outlines over 1,000 years of peaceful coexistence. Our ancestors came in here as traders. The Commission of Inquiry states that the first traders came here in about the 7th century AD. And this book establishes the mutually beneficial relationship the Muslims shared with the Sinhalese community of Sri Lanka, which laid the foundation for racial and religious amity. The Muslim traders brought enormous assets, and the Sinhala monarchs of the time offered protection and permitted them to settle. We have remained in amity and sought to make our investment here in Sri Lanka. This is our motherland. Our assets and finances remain in Sri Lanka. We did not plunder this country like the Dutch, Portuguese, and British. The Sinhalese, Tamils, and Christians are our brothers in our quest to serve our mother Lanka, and nobody can or should take that right from us. When the Muslims were demanded to support the LTTE or be evicted from the north, we, the Muslims of Sri Lanka, chose to lose our homes and our belongings to be loyal to our motherland. We gave up our assets and our livelihood to live as refugees. I was also one of those evicted by the LTTE. We earned the wrath of the LTTE because we chose to love our motherland over our own life. We have lived with you, among you, as one of you. We have loved each other, protected each other, shared in the spoils of war, and celebrated our victory over separatism. We Muslims never asked to be regarded separately. We only asked to be given the right to live as Sri Lankans, as Muslims. I must admit there were extremist elements who exploited the name of Islam and caused turmoil. The terrorists behind the East attacks are not Muslims. They are terrorists that hijack the name of Islam for their own sinister agendas. I am not here to defend them. I cannot and will not defend or support any terrorist, even if my life was on the line. I am here to tell you that we, the Muslim community, will stand with you today and forever against any and all forms of terrorism and violent extremism. Today is the fifth day of the debate on the Commission of Inquiry report on the East attack. The Parliamentary Select Committee, appointed by the then Speaker, and the Commission of Inquiry, appointed by then President, have both exonerated me from all of crass allegation, falsely linking me with those terrorists. Ever since the East attacks, Honorable Vimal Veeravansa has been making controversial statements at my expense. He says that I was in contact with Zahran even when there is no evidence, because I or my brother had never known or met Zahran in our lives. He made this statement in a program named Islam Antavadeya Pasku Commission Obbata on this year, February. His entire speech during the program provoked both the Muslim and Sinhala youths. He incited racism and religious bigotry. I asked the CID to inquire on this program. I have formally submitted a complaint, but nothing has happened. The commission does not mention anything as such. This is what has to be stopped. On page 331 of this report, the commission report is quoted. Reciprocal radicalization is the cycle of radicalization which promotes each other's radicalized ideologies. I would say that if the government can keep their own representatives like Vimal Veerawansa in check and prevent them from inciting racism, the de-radicalization program will be half complete. He even made allegation against a renowned government entity claiming that Satosa vehicles have been used to transport Zaharan, which is now proven to be just words to mislead the public for his political motives. I am challenging you as a minister in the current government to prove those allegations with facts and figures, what you said. The report only refers to me in respect of two allegations. One is regarding the sale of scrap metal to Colossus Private Limited from IDB under my ministry that time. Here too, the commission has not made any findings but states that this is a matter to be taken up by the bribery commission. I plan to visit the bribery commission tomorrow, inshallah, and ask them to inquire this immediately, because I want to prove without a doubt that I have no involvement with these terrorists. Secondly, the commission of inquiry has referred to a call I made to the Army Commander General Mahesh Senanayake. This was a call only to inquire if Ihsan Mohinuddin was in the custody of the law enforcement authorities. His father, who is a class 1 special grade SLAS officer and an additional secretary to a ministry, is known to me, and he called me as a concerned parent. He not only called me but also wrote to the then president and the media on the abduction of his son. Firstly, I called the OIC of Dehivala, then SSP Vikramasinghe in Dehivala division, who responded saying that he has not been arrested by the police, and he suggested me to check with the army. Then I called the general Mahesh Senanayake to make an inquiry, and he said he wasn't aware and that he would try to find out. I called him a second time to find out if progress was made, and again he said he could not check it. The third time I called, he told me that Ihsan was in their custody, and that was the end of it. For the information of this house, I table this affidavit with all relevant document and evidence I have submitted to the commission. People seem to perceive this phone call to the army commander very negatively. I ask them, what is wrong in what I did? It is the right of every citizen in this country to make inquiries from the lawful authorities in this country. I am an elected representative. I am a representative of the people, and it is my obligation to make inquiries in these times on behalf of them. The commission report on page 395 also makes reference to a call made by Minister Honorable Dayasiri Jayasekara. Dayasiri Jayasekara, Minister, intervened on behalf of 6 people who were arrested by the Bingiriya police and brought to the Hettipola police station. He even got permission from the DIG Kurunegala to have them released on police bail and transported them in his vehicle. Those were people arrested for torching and destroying Muslim owned shops and Muslim places of worship. They attack innocent Muslims. This is a commission report, but no action had been recommended by the commission against him. Why? I wish to clearly mention that such people are also extremists. But what did I do? I made legitimate inquiries of the whereabout of a missing person whose father was serving the state in a higher position. Over 2,000 Muslims were arrested over the Easter Sunday attacks. This was the only person in regard to whom I made inquiries. Why? It was because he was kidnapped. That is a legitimate right that any citizen is entitled to exercise. The fake news media say I was trying to influence the army commander. I am tabling here the video clip and other evidence of the testimony of the general Mahesh Senanayake, where he admits that I never influenced. That is a preposterous allegation. have some humanity. I ask the parents who are listening, how would you feel if your child was kidnapped? Imagine the plight of the father of this child. Would you not have acted in the same manner? I just made an inquiry and the media went into a frenzy. But here we have, in the case of Honorable Dayasiri Jayasekara, an elected representative against whom I have nothing personal, not just making an inquiry, but intervening on behalf of criminals in non-bailable offences, securing sureties and securing their release. From this, we can learn that justice was not meted out evenly. I wish to ask all concerned parties, why was greater weight placed on my call to the Army Commander over and above the action of Dayasiri Jayasekara? Is it because I am a Muslim? If so, is it not discrimination? The report also identifies that several local government members were instigating violence. The report points out that the police did nothing to stop these mobs. Apparently, they did not have strength. These attacks were anticipated. Curfew was in motion. It is the duty of law enforcement authorities to enforce the law. They were aware of the situation and did not reinforce security in the areas. They allowed the mobs to create unrest at will. This was willfully executed against a religious minority in this country. However, not enough. Action has been taken till now. If my call to the Army Commander had received such prominence, why are such strong matters just limited to a few paragraphs in the report? I must ask. The report reveals several incidents of violence post-Easter. There were 78 incidents in Minu Angoda, 37 incidents in Kuliyapitiya, 200 incidents in Hattipola, 9 incidents in Chilo, 47 incidents in Koswatha, 67 incidents in Nikavaratiya, 55 incidents in Nigambu, and many more incidents against the Muslims. If you look at the involvement of some of these local government members and the non-involvement of law enforcement authorities, it definitely seemed like state-sponsored oppression against minorities. Fauzul Amir, Muhammad Salih of Kotramula, poor man, lost his life in front of these criminals, in front of these criminals, to these extremists, in front of them, their children. In any other country, this would be reported as genocide, and all the inflammatory speeches would be branded as incitement to genocide under the Genocide Convention. I wish to table the Genocide Convention before this House. The state has allowed the killing of Muslims. The state has allowed bodily harm to Muslims. The state has now begun imposing conditions that threaten the physical destruction of Muslims. This is genocide under Article 2. Do not forget that we are now part of the Rome Statute and we are accountable for our actions and omissions. In view of these incidents, I must once again extend my sincerest of the gratitude to His Eminent Cardinal Malcolm Ranjit. In the wake of an outbreak of post-Easter violence, he effectively managed to limit the damage. His actions were exemplary of the virtues of the faith of the Catholics. I would like to make reference to certain points from the report on page 145. The report states that 17 video recordings were made by Zaharan and his group. In those videos, he gives 10 reasons why Sri Lanka was chosen for the attack. I call upon all members of the House to pay full attention to some of these points. One, defaming and insulting Allah. Incident in Kuliyapitiya, where an image of a pig with Allah was written on it. Number three, Venerable Galagodate Nyanasara Thero, insinuating that Allah will be reborn. Number four, scolding and defaming Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Number five, tearing and burning of Quran. Number six, destruction of mosque. Number seven, destroying Muslim houses and forcible land grabs. Number eight, rape of a Muslim woman by intelligence officials and its cover up. I would like to ask, who is to take responsibility for these? Is it the Muslims or the state? Incident that never happened in 1,000 years have happened in 10 years soon after the end of the LTT war. It is not the Muslims, but certain extremist elements that provoke the sentiments of the Muslims, and more importantly, the government allowed these elements to operate freely. His Eminent Cardinal Malcolm Ranjith addressed the people in Kottampitiya and publicly stated that it wasn't the Muslim community who was at fault. He identifies that an external hand was involved. I also feel the same. I urge the authorities to identify and bring to book this external hand, regardless of religion, stature, or political position. Honorable Chair, we must understand that such extremists gain power at the expense of our failures to protect our people. When people are dejected by the fact that their government is not interested in protecting them, they are likely to develop animosity and anger towards the government. They are likely to join hands with people who are ready to oppose the government at any cost, because they are losing hope that the government will protect them. This is the normal reaction of any human being. We do not, however, justify any form of violence. If you antagonize repeatedly an entire community for the crimes of a few, you will note their lack of willingness to stand by you. Eventually, they will get more and more radicalized and stand against you. It is not like we haven't seen this before. It is that we haven't learned from these mistakes. Look at the history of the ethnic conflict with the LTTE. The 1956 single only act was instrumental in creating anger among the Tamils. Further actions, including burning of the Jaffna library, triggered their emotion, and then war had become inevitable. The Controversial Prevention of Terrorism Act was used more often ruthlessly. It was brought as a temporary act. The then government thought that armed with the PTA, they could finish off opposition in 2 years. But what happened? The abuse of the PTA and oppressive tactics dragged the war for 30 years. But the problems that led to the war still remain unresolved. The UNHRC has demanded the repeal of the PTA. The government should not repeat the same mistakes now against the Muslims. Thereafter, you will anger the Muslim countries that stood with us in our adversities. If we had learned from these mistakes, we would not have permitted the extremist actions against innocent Muslims. We can still be hopeful. The Muslims are peace-loving people. Long before the attacks, Muslims owned the government. In the aftermath of the East attacks, the Muslims helped the armed forces track down the terrorists and neutralize them. The Muslims are on the side of the nation. Do not push us away. Don't push us away. Don't compel us to give up our religion. The vast majority of Sri Lankans chose to side with the state because it is our faith that has taught us to side with the nation. It is our faith that taught us that Zaharan and his group were wrong. It is our faith that taught us to expose his group of extremists. A very good example was the incident which took place in Saindamardu on 26th April. Following the East attacks, where a Muslim family gave information to the security forces on the whereabouts of Zaharan's family, his family. We Muslims consider Zaharan not as a Muslim. They are terrorists. They have tried to force your hand. They want you to make mistakes. The commission report in page 94 confirms that Zaharan wanted to build tensions between the Muslims and Sinhalese of this country. Therefore, it is imperative that you act wisely. Don't play to his tunes. Don't compromise national harmony. In the name of national security, do not take actions that would jeopardize that very national security. The process of state sponsors discrimination has already commenced. For example, a notice signed under the hand of Deputy
Honorable
Director
Member,
of Customs.
You have another two more minutes.
Please give me, I think till 4:30 I can give me. The Customs dated 5th, Deputy Director of Customs dated 5th of March 2021 states that any Islamic religious books brought into the country should only be released upon the approval of the Ministry of Defense. There is also word from the Minister of Law and Order that madrasas are to be banned. As a member of the Muslim community, I am offended, and so are my people. These are acts of discrimination and particularly a violation of the right of Muslim to manifest their religion. Minister of Law and Order also informs that there will be a burqa ban. People are mandated to wear masks all over the country and all over the world. You cannot make a description under any act to ban the burqa and niqab unless you also ban the medical masks, the motorcycle helmet, sunglasses, spectacles, bandages, and so many other pieces of garments. I wish to ask the minister, how do you constitutionally make such a law? How do you make a law with such effect without making it racist and Islamophobic? We as minorities of this country are all entitled to our constitutional right to practice and manifest our religion freely in this country. Any legislation or administrative action targeting one particular community is a violation of our constitution. It is also in violation of every non-core convention and treaty ratified by Sri Lanka. No monitoring body of any of these treaties, let alone the UNHRC, is going to spare our country for acting so arbitrarily against the Muslim community. This is extremism in another form. This is oppression. We, the peace-loving people of this country, will not stand for extremism and will most definitely not stand for discrimination, even if it is endorsed by the state. The commission report will hold good testimony that other groups have engaged in extremist activity. The activities of Venerable Kalagodavatte Nyanasara has been highlighted for term he coined Abasaranai, and the report calls for the proscription of the Bodubala Sena. Further, in page 332 of this commission report, that the AG considers instituting criminal proceedings against him under the ICCPR Act for his speeches made during the Maharagama and Alutgama incident. They have also highlighted organizations such as Singhala Ravaya, Mahevsan Balakaya, Singhala Jatika Balamuluwa, Singhala Jatika Samvidhanaya, and the Shiva Sena movement. It is not me who is presuming their extremist nature, but the commission report serves as my evidence. The actions of these extremists began in 2011, and owing to impunity, the extremism grew. If not for the impunity of these extremist thugs, the Easter attacks would have been unlikely to have happened. Where do you believe their extremist nature comes from? Over and above the commission report, there is plenty of ideographic evidence of their extremism. What measures do you propose to quell the extremism in these factions? At least will you de-radicalize them first? DHR, I draw your attention to the arrest of Muslims who have been very vocal against the acts of Zahran. It has been about 22 days since Azad Sali was arrested. I must remind you that it was he who publicly stated in 2017 that Zahran was a dangerous criminal who needs to be arrested. Yet the government has arrested him under the Prevention of Terrorism Act for alleged connection to the Easter attacks. How is this fair? You are holding him without a charge only because he was spoke on behalf of the Muslim community. This is political victimization. Another distinguished personality who has actively contributed efforts towards the upkeep of human rights, Hijaz Hizbullah Attorney at Law, has also been arrested under the PTA. Ahnaf Jazim from Pandaravali Mannar was arrested for a poem he wrote against the ISIS. He was arrested on April 15 last year and continues to be detained with no charges against him simply because he wrote a poem against the ISIS. Under the pretext of national security, you have oppressed the Muslims. I am afraid their frustrations from your actions may lead to radicalization. You must arrest the extremists who have harmed or will harm our people. But whether or not you are arresting the extremists, you are definitely arresting innocent people who are speaking against extremism. There is another word for this oppression. The country's policies must not be biased against the whole Muslim community. This is not what is intended through the one country, one law policy. In no country there are different sets of laws applicable to different segments of the society other than in confederate states. Even in federal countries such as America, all laws, whether federal or state, including state constitutions, are in conformity with the federal constitution. In Sri Lanka too, there is only one constitution which provides for enactment of provincial statutes containing differing clauses, yet so long as they are consistency with the provisions of constitution, they fall within the concept of one country, one law. What is understandably alluded to as one country, one law in Sri Lanka is the targeted elimination of the personal laws, particularly the Muslim personal law. The constitution has guaranteed the freedom of religion and culture, etc., in Article 10, 14, and 9. Personal laws mean personal to specific communities. The Buddhist, Hindu, Christian, and Islamic communities have laws personal to them. They are relating to either their religions or their cultures, which in no way infringe on the right of others. In the first place, if you are to do away with personal laws, then all these laws have to be removed from the statute book. Be that as it may, if you take marriages, for instance, marriages need not be registered under any law. If the girl reaches the age of 16, she can live with anyone she wishes, even without formalizing the union in any manner, whether legal or cultural, under the Sri Lankan law. In Sri Lanka, there are hundreds of elderly couples who have not got their marriages registered, particularly in the Hill Country and Jaffna. What the laws relating to marriages to do is that they give extra protection to the union of couple. That's all. Since constitution guaranteed their freedom of religion and culture, the personal laws gives a legal cover to the enjoyment of such freedom. In what way can it be construed as different laws? What is surreptitiously clothed in the slogan "One country, one law" is to call for assimilation, which is an antithesis of integration. Assimilation is to deny diversity and expect everyone to follow one culture and one way of life, which is not possible in any part of the world. Integration is to call for unity whilst recognizing diversity. The preamble of our constitution has recognized this diversity by employing the word peoples in itself. I call upon everyone to understand the difference between assimilation and integration on the one hand.
Time is up.
So please do not hurt the sentiments of all Muslims, because it can only marginalize the Muslim community even more. We have lived in peace practicing these customs and tradition in marriage for over 800 years. It has never become a problem to any person. Do not try to abolish our customs and traditions. It will not be a positive step towards de-radicalization. Talking of de-radicalization, a gazette was passed on March 12, 2021 with reference to a proposed rehabilitation and re-radicalization program. This is, we can't accept that. That is only focusing on the Muslims. That is not work for the country. I am sure the majority of the monks in Sri Lanka are peace-loving people who truly believe in the four immeasurable metta, karuna, mudita and upeka. Many of these monks tend to disagree with the violent ways of some of these extremists, and I am certain they will be willing to assist in these in the process of rehabilitation and de-radicalization of the extremists amongst them. Actually, I want to say something. I am tabling my speech, full speech, with that, and I want to ask the chair, please, include my speech, all this paragraph, ask to ACJU address matters. They actually they work hard to guide our community against Zaharan like criminals. I think they did a lot of activities. I am tabling this book. There are 34 in action they taken. Another one I was in the page or Sila Vishengali, Tamililum Cholavandam, Mele, Jamaat Islamudaiya Thalaivar, Agirinda, Hajjul Akbarai, Kaidu Seidhirukkar. ஜமாத் இஸ்லாம் என்பது ஒரு பெரிய பாரிய இயக்கமாக இந்த நாட்டிலே பல நல்ல பணிகளை செய்தவர்கள் இந்த கொலையோடு சஹரானுடைய குரூப்போடு இணைந்தவர்கள் அதிலே முன்னர் இருந்தவர்கள் அந்த அமைப்பால் விலக்கப்பட்டவர்கள் சம்பந்தப்பட்டார்களே ஒழிய தற்பொழுது ஜமாத் இஸ்லாம் உறுப்பினர்கள் யாரும் இருப்பவர்கள் யாரும் சம்பந்தப்படவில்லை ஹஜ்ஜுல் அக்பர் மீது சுமத்தப்பட்ட குற்றச்சாட்டுகளுக்கான பதிலை அவர் இங்கு வெளியிட்டிருக்கிறார் எனவே ஸ்ரீலங்கா ஜமாத் இஸ்லாமால் வெளியிடப்பட்டிருக்கின்ற இந்த அவருடைய அவர் சார்ந்த விளக்கத்தை அவர் மீது சொல்லப்பட்ட குற்றச்சாட்டுக்கு எதிரான விளக்கத்தை இந்த பாராளுமன்றத்திலே நான் அதாவது டேபிள் பண்ணுமாறு வேண்டுகோள் விடுக்கின்றேன் அதே போல இங்கு இந்த நாட்டிலே ஒரு இனத்தை மையப்படுத்தி அவர்களின் மீது உங்களுடைய கவனத்தை செலுத்தி அவர்களை அடக்க நினைக்காதீர்கள் நாட்டின் மீது பாசம் கொள்ளுங்கள் இந்த 70 வருஷங்களுக்கு மேலாக சுதந்திரம் கிடைத்த பிறகு இந்த நாட்டிலே 30 வருஷம் தமிழ் மக்களோடு போராட்டம் 30 வருஷத்துக்கு பிறகு 10 வருஷத்துக்குள்ளே தான் முஸ்லிம்களின் மீது டிகனையிலே தம்புள்ளையிலே காலியிலே கிராண்ட் பாஸிலே அங்கே இங்கே எல்லா இடங்களிலும் முஸ்லிம்களை தாக்கினார்கள் ஏ கலபகடவத்த ஞானசார தேரர் அபசரணா என்று அபசரணா என்பது அழிவை நோக்கிய வசனம் கொலை செய்வதற்கான ஒரு வசனம் அவ்வாறான ஒரு வசனத்தை பேசிய பிறகுதான் அழுக்கமையிலே 4 பேர் கொல்லப்பட்டார்கள் நூற்றுக்கணக்கான சொத்துக்கள் அழிக்கப்பட்டது இந்த கொலை செய்த சஹரான் கூட்டம் செய்த செயல்பாட்டை நாங்கள் அங்கீகரிக்கவில்லை ஆனால் அவர்கள் ஏன் இதை செய்தோம் இலங்கையில் ஏன் இதை செய்தோம் என்று சொல்லி இருக்கிறார்கள் அந்த விஷயங்களை நான் ஏற்கனவே சொன்னேன் எனவே அந்த விஷயங்களை கவனத்திலே கொண்டு இந்த நாட்டிலே அவ்வாறான அநியாயங்கள் இந்த நாட்டிலே நடக்காமல் இஸ்லாத்துக்கு எதிராக செயல்படுகின்ற ஒரு சில மத குருமார் இவர்கள் எல்லாம் ஏஜென்ட்கள் இவர்கள் எல்லாம் ஒய்ஸ்கட்காரர்கள் கூலிப்படை இவர்களான இந்த நாட்டை குட்டிச்சுவராக்குகிறார்கள் இவர்களை கட்டுப்படுத்துங்கள் இவர்களை கட்டுப்படுத்தவில்லை என்றால் இப்படியான இன்னல்கள் இப்படியான அழிவுகள் வருவதற்கு அது காரணமாக அமைந்துவிடும் எனவே அவ்வாறான அழிவுகள் வரக்கூடாது வரக்கூடாமல் இருப்பதற்காக எங்களாலான முழு ஒத்துழைப்பை நான் மட்டுமல்ல எமது முஸ்லிம் சமூகம் உங்களுக்கு தருவதற்காக இந்த நாட்டுக்கு அது எந்த அரசாங்கம் இருந்தாலும் அவர்களோடு சேர்ந்து இவ்வாறான மோசமான காரியங்கள் நடக்காமல் இருப்பதற்கு உண்மையான இஸ்லாத்தின்படி இஸ்லாமிகளை வாழச் செய்வதற்கு எங்களுடைய பூரண ஒத்துழைப்பை தருகிறோம் உண்மையாக குற்றவாளிகளை தண்டியுங்கள் அப்பாவிகளை உடனடியாக விடுதலை செய்யுங்கள் நூற்றுக்கணக்கான அப்பாவிகள் இருக்கிறார்கள் எனவே அவர்களை விடுதலை செய்யுங்கள் என்று கேட்டு விடைபெறுகிறேன் நன்றி
ஸ்துதி பாராளுமன்ற ஹெட் பெற